Greetings. It's so good to see you. Thank you so much for tuning in and watching our broadcast here at Cave Spring Baptist Church. At Cave Spring, we don't do church as normal, and we're okay with that. We want to just come together and worship a risen Savior. We want to give glory and honor to God for what He's done for us, and we do that in corporate worship here, and we are excited about what He's doing. So I pray that you are blessed by what you experience and what you hear and how you see us just worship Jesus Christ, our Lord. Also, you would not even imagine the impact that you can make through your giving. If you'll notice at the bottom of your screen, you'll see that there's a website. If you'll go to that website, we have a link that will take you to an opportunity to sow a seed into this ministry, and know that every seed that is sown goes to the glory and building of the kingdom of God. So I pray that you'll pray for what God will have you do, but we want you to worship with us and praise the risen Savior, Jesus Christ. I pray you get something out of this today. Be blessed. God bless you. We love you. Today we want to finish what we started last week with the title, Our Divine Appointment, Our Divine Appointment. And you know what happens every time I think we've got a short sermon, right? So I hope the roast is on low. Sure good to be with everybody this morning. God bless you. I pray you've had a great week. Next week on April 9th, we'll have our Easter egg hunt at 4:30. Now, of course, we'll have an amazing day that morning. That morning in worship, we're going to study a specific word. We're going to look at this day just a little bit different next week. Next week, we're going to look at a specific word called Yada, and we're going to see what it means to truly worship, truly just give ourselves to the Father. So this next week, be in prayer for next Sunday morning. Pray that God, we would just be in the presence of the Father like never before. And then that night we'll have our Easter egg hunt at 4:30, and that will be in place of church. But you don't want to miss the Yada. Our divine appointment. And there was a scripture we looked at last week. It's 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and we're going to just look at verse 10. Just verse 10 for just a few moments. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 10. Everybody there? Amen? Amen. Look what it says. For we all must appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether it be good or bad. And you know, we looked at this last week, and it says, for we must what? All. Everybody say all. Everybody say me. There you go. That's what it means. Me, you, all of us. We're going to stand before the Father, stand before Christ, and each one of us is going to receive the things that we've done in this body. Now, this body is the body of Christ, the things that we've done. As a believer, we're going to look and we're going to see the things and share those things. Those things are going to be revealed to us. Well, we have to ask ourselves, what is it that we want to accomplish here, this side of glory? This side of glory, what do we want to accomplish? Let's pray together. Thank you, Father, for your word. For it is a true and living and a more excellent word. Thank you, Father, for the joy of our salvation. But Father, may we take this and know that one day we get to stand before you, Father. Thank you, Father, for loving us.
Thank you, Father, for your Son. God, we're just so thankful for how you love us. And God, I pray that as we go through this day, that we'll see we're supposed to love like you loved. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. What is it that we want to accomplish here, this side of glory? What is on our list? A bucket list, if you would. What is on that list for us to do for the Father? What is it that we're supposed to do, that we want to do, done, those things in this body, the body of Christ, according to what we've done? What are we going to do? What do we want to accomplish? We need to define what our role is. In other words, we need to have a good old DTR, define the relationship with God, you see. For we're going to stand before Christ and give an account of everything that we've done. Oh, and you can be assured that He knows. He just wants you to tell Him. Can you imagine? It's sort of like your mama. She knows what you did, but yet she asked you, what did you do? You know how many times I heard that growing up? Brad, what'd you do? She knew what I'd done. And all of it wasn't good. You ain't going to be able to say, just like you did with your mama, I don't know. Because He knows. You know, it's a funny thing, she knew too, didn't she? People are waiting. See, this is what we got to see. People are waiting. They're waiting for us to go and tell them about Jesus. People are waiting. Now, I want to tell you something. There's going to be a periodic door you knock onto, and they're going to look at you and go, well, I ain't got it. I ain't want it. I don't need it. Goodbye. But I want you to know that folks are waiting to hear the gospel. They're primed and ready. The Bible tells us that the harvest is ready. Somebody go. You know, we talked last week about some folks just believe since they're saved and they've made a profession of faith that they're just good to go. Well, I agree with the term, but I don't agree with their theology. It is that we are good to go and share the gospel. We can't just bask in the rays of His sunshine and think we're good. You see, God has given us everything that we need for life and godliness. He's given us everything we need. And then we understand that we can't be ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation for everybody. We know that if He is for us, then who can be against us? See, the problem here is we let things, circumstances, even people limit what we can do in Christ Jesus. I tell you, if we start living our life, and I'm looking at myself in the mirror, you hear me? I'm looking at myself, but if we were to start living our life for Jesus, Lord have mercy, this building couldn't hold them all. Amen or oh me? Y'all awake? Hey, y'all. Really? If we live the life that Christ wants us to live, if the believers in this world were to do that, I want to tell you something, there ain't enough churches to hold them all. We've got to understand that we're going to stand before Christ one day. We can't sit around and complain and moan and groan about who's not here. And we got to celebrate who is here, and His name is Jesus, and go after the ones that are not. We can't limit what we can do based upon what everybody else is doing. Don't let it hinder your spiritual growth. My Lord, we've got to stop looking around and start looking up to Christ. And for so long, we're worried about what someone else is doing down the road. They serve the same Christ. They serve the same God. All we've got to do is start living our lives the way God wants us to live them. You know, we always hear, well, they this and they that. Well, I want to know who they are. I serve a mighty God. I serve a great and mighty God, a Savior who walked out of the empty tomb on the third day. He's seated at the right hand of God, just waiting for us to come, just waiting to come and come and get us. He's given us all we need to share the gospel. I don't care what anybody else is doing. I care about what I'm doing. Am I sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ? I care that I'm portraying and projecting the Father under the finished works of Christ. I want to tell you something. I want you to hear me. I don't want to be a regular church. We know that we do church different than everybody else. I don't want to be a regular church. I want to be a supernatural church. I want to be a church where things happen. I want to be a church where folks' lives get changed, where folks get healed, where folks get saved. I want to be a supernatural church where something happens every day of the week. The Sunday-Wednesday mentality is over. It's over. We've got to worship Christ every day. Are you having church every day? Now, you might not come to this building, but are you having church every day of your life, every day of the week, every day are you having church? I'm begging you to have church every day, not just 15 minutes, not just 30 minutes, not just worship Him, because throughout your entire day, God has showed up. He's already here. He showed up. Are we doing something about Christ in our day? He's here. You see, we have sort of got away from that. Are we getting so close to God? We're just feeling His presence all the time. Let me give you a little illustration. Edgar and I was in the car the other day. We were driving to Tennessee, honestly. And listen, we started talking in the car, and we talked about, listen, I sort of pointed this out. Edgar, if you'll remember, I said, y'all see them power lines? Me and Edgar and Eric Maddox, we were all together. And I said, there's, you know, those power lines, there's electricity in those power lines. Now, I want to tell you something. There's only three ways that you can access the power that are in them power lines. Three ways. You hear me? Number one, you can touch it. Now, I don't advise this. You might get a little Pentecostal on us. Huh? Ha! You know what I'm saying? Y'all ever been under one of them preachers that did that all the time? Every time he took a breath, it was ha! He touching the power lines. Ha! Got a little Pentecostal. Listen, I'm not making fun of them. I grew up one, okay? Amen. First of all, you can touch it. Secondly of all, you can plug into it. You can plug into it. You can plug into the power. There's power sources everywhere. There's plugs on the wall. You can just plug into it and you have electricity because the power is in the lines. They're in the lines. Okay? Now, the third way you can do it, see, you can touch it, all right? Then you can plug into it, and then there's the third way. What's the third way? You got to flip the switch. And I'm going to tell you something. There's a lot of Christians out there that not only need to plug into it, but they need to start flipping the switch. Let me ask you a question. When you walk into a dark room, what do? You flip the switch. Everybody say it with me. Flip the switch. I'm going to tell you something. When you walk out them doors, maybe sometimes when you walk in, you better start flipping the switch because the world is dark and needs Jesus. They need the power of God, for it is salvation. We can't be ashamed of it, you see. See, yes, there's power there. God's given us everything we need according to life and godliness, for life and godliness, that if we just tap into it, plug into it, flip it, and yes, maybe some of us, bless God, need to touch it. You see, the power is there. Through Christ, you have the power to go and to share the gospel, to make the difference for the kingdom of God. what's going on in our daily lives because God is with you. See, our example of love and patience with those who are lost and hurting, Jesus needs them. He needs you to share the gospel. You know that person that cussed you out? Just smile and share Jesus, because I want you to hear something. It wasn't them that cussed you out. It was the very demon of hell that was using them to ruin your witness that cussed you out. So I'm going to tell you something. Look at it a little different. I've said it from time to time. It's not what they do to you. It's how you treat them. You see, when we act accordingly and we act according to what God wants us to act, people see the Father inside of us. They see that He's real. But I want to tell you something. If you let the demons of hell get against you and you let someone just be used and come after you, then our actions are going to show, is God living inside of this person or is He not? We got to flip the switch, turn on the power of Christ. We have to stop acting as if we have no power. Stop acting as if we have no Christ in us. He needs for us to just understand that He's got to work through us. Through us. He needs to come out of our mouth and come out of our ears and come out of every part of who we are to show the anointing on Christ Jesus and who He is. You see, it's about how we live our lives every day, because we're going to have a divine appointment one day. There's going to be one day that you stand before the judgment seat of Christ and you're not going to be able to stand there and go, I don't know. You're not going to be able to stand there and go, well, you know, Brother Brad said this, Brother Jason said this, Brother Eric said this. You can't do that. Because He's going to look at you and say, well, what did I say? Lord, that wasn't even part of the sermon. That was just the introduction, y'all. At times I don't understand. And you know, I try to live my life understanding, okay? I try to understand. But I have trouble. Jim, I have trouble understanding sometimes that the power of God is here. It's here. You didn't bring it in. As much as you want to believe that you brought it in, you didn't bring it in. You hear me? It's all ready here. You got to get a hold of it three ways. In your life, you got to tap into it somehow. You got to either touch it, plug into it, or Lord, flip the switch. You might be sitting here this morning and folks, you might be sitting here this morning and there's something going on in your life that you just quite can't put your finger on it. Okay? You just can't put your finger on it. But there's something not, or you know how that feels. You know that feeling. It's just something that's just not there. It's not right. You're struggling with something. Can I ask you, why don't you believe that God can handle it? Why don't we believe God can handle it? And you're probably sitting there thinking, well, I believe God can do it. Then let Him. Huh? Because when you stand before Christ that day on your divine appointment, you cannot, will not have a pity party. It's just not going to happen. Because you know, you can't. And so God wants us to be ready for that day. So let's not have one now. Let's worship. Let's do something for Jesus. Let's do something for Jesus today, okay, other than going to church. Let's do something for Him because we have a divine appointment. God, why do you think God sent His Son to die for us? Was it for us to go to church twice a week? Once a week? No. It was for us to have a relationship with us through Christ Jesus because it didn't work. The sacrifice of bulls and calves didn't work. It didn't work. There was over 600 laws and they couldn't keep none of them. They weren't supposed to because the laws were set up to show the people that they needed God. They didn't need the law. Because, you know, He said, if you break one law, you're guilty of what? Oh, okay. So listen, He just wants to have a relationship with you and for you to share the gospel. He's given you everything you need for a life in godliness. It's there. It's already there. Whatever you need, it's done. It was done on the cross. I know you're tired of me talking about this, but I'm going to talk about it until the cows come home or you get healed to begin with. You see, it's that we've got to understand that we've got to tap into the power. Tap into what God wants for us. Tap into the glory. Tap into the majesty of God and understand that He's Lord and I'm not. He's Lord. He's the one that died on a cross. He's the one that rose from the dead. He's the one that's sitting at the right hand of God. He's Lord. And the Bible tells us that He's given us everything we need and that He had to go so that the Holy Spirit would come. And if the Holy Spirit comes, we will do far greater things than He ever did. I don't know where we've messed up on that. We have messed up on that. It's all about Him and it's not about us. It's all of Him and none of me. None of me. Not just a little part. I don't want no part. I don't want no part. I want to just be what He wants me to be. Now I want to tell you something. You're going to stand before every one of you. Right, we're talking about saved folk now. Okay? Every one of you is going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ. I want to show you five crowns. And so here's the sermon, okay? I want to give you five crowns that you'll receive and that you'll cast at the feet of Jesus. Are you ready for these five? Because these are very important. There's five crowns at your divine appointment. This is where you will stand before Christ and you're going to just bless Him. Are you ready to bless Jesus? Because He blessed you, right? Did He bless you? He blessed us. I want to give you five crowns that will just, in your daily walk, I pray they'll change your life because you're going to cast them. You know what I almost thought about doing? Was I thought about going to Burger King, see if I can get 200 crowns. You know? That would have been awesome, wouldn't it? Can you imagine all of us sitting around with a crown on our head? I thought that'd been cool, right? Really? That'd been cool, all of us sitting around with crowns on our head. And then I got to thinking, you probably already have them on your head. You know, I've had this mental image all morning long, okay? And so I tried not to grin during worship. And you know, when I looked up here at these guys and when I saw y'all walking in the hallway for Sunday school, just in case, if you didn't make it for Sunday school, small groups, we have a really great time at small groups. Y'all come join us, okay? Anyways, I look up here and I see you in the hallway and I can even look out over you right now and I can literally picture crowns on your head. Isn't that something? I guess it means that much. Your first crown, look at the crown of victory. The crown of victory. I love this crown, don't you? 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 25 says, every man that striveth for the mastery of is temporal in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible crown. I want you to understand something real quick. See, this crown is about spiritual things. This crown is this crown tells us about how we're living our life spiritually. In Romans chapter 8 and verse 6, it says, "For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace, because the carnal mind is the enemy against God." It says that we cannot walk in the flesh, but we've got to walk in the Spirit to please God. This crown of victory, this is Christ's accomplishments in your life. This is not your accomplishments. This is an incorruptible crown. It's that Jesus is alive inside of you. Something's happening. Something's stirring. There's this eruption fixing to happen in your life, and folks are going to get saved. Your life is going to be changed. There's going to be so much victory spiritually in your life that you won't be able to contain yourself. You'll have to share the gospel. You'll have to tell people about Jesus. Your whole life is about to change. I don't know about you, but don't you believe it's time for your life to change? I want you to understand that's the crown of victory in your life. It has nothing to do with things that pass away. It has nothing to do with your body. It has nothing to do with your actions. It has everything to do about what Christ is doing inside of you. So let Him do something in you and let your life change. See, that's the crown of victory. You're going to stand before Christ one day and give yourself to Christ, that He is Lord of all. And you're going to cast this crown before the feet of Jesus because you have allowed Him to live through you every day of your life. See, that's the crown of victory. Victory. Letting Christ live through you. Victory. See, the only way we can have victory is for Christ to be in us. See, obedience must come first, but that crown of victory is Christ living inside of us that we just can't help but let it out. Look at here. Your second crown is the crown of rejoicing. Your crown of rejoicing. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 18, Wherefore we would have come unto you, even I, Paul, once and again, but Satan hindered us. For what is our hope, he says, what is our joy? What is our crown of rejoicing? And not even ye in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ that is coming, for ye are our glory and joy. The crown of rejoicing. This is not the crown of right conditions. This is not. Doesn't matter what you're going through. You got to rejoice. You see, we only want to worship. We only want to give Christ His due when everything is going right. When the conditions are perfect, you know. We've got to worship Him and give glory to Him regardless of what's going on, because we're going to stand before Christ one day at our divine appointment, and we're going to have this crown, and we want to know, and we want Him to acknowledge and to see that regardless of what we went through, we worshiped Him and we gave Him glory. We were excited about what God is doing. We took this crown of victory because Jesus was living inside of us, and we turned it in to the crown of rejoicing. And that's the crown of gladness. That's the crown of hope. That's the crown of Jesus is Lord of my life. And I want you to understand, there's so many people that are choosing not to wear this crown because they refuse to be a soul winner for Jesus Christ. If we're going to be a soul winner for Jesus Christ, we know we've got to have the crown of rejoicing, because we're going to go through trials. And listen, I want to tell you something. You might be going through a trial, but when you're going through your worst trial, God's going to put someone in your path that needs Jesus. When you're hurting the most, that's when you need to witness the most. When you're down and you've not done what you're supposed to do spiritually, that's when you need to get out and start worshiping God. That's when you don't feel like worshiping, you need to worship. Huh? See, we've got to have the crown. We're going to have the crown of victory, the spiritual excitement. We've got to have the crown of rejoicing. The third crown we find is the crown of righteousness. The crown of righteousness, allowing God, the living character of God living through us. the character of God living through us. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, in 2 Timothy chapter 4, we find this one. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not only to me, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Now I want to tell you something. Some folks look at this and they go, okay, well, I'm going to get this when he comes back. No, I want you to understand that we've got to be excited that we're loving his appearing, that we love the fact that he's showing up, that we're giving ourselves to him, and that we're letting God live through us. See, that's the crown of righteousness. If you want the crown of victory, then you better start letting Christ live in you. Be excited about what God is doing. If you want the crown of rejoicing, know with all your heart that even under the worst conditions and the worst circumstances in your life, you're going to worship. And the crown of righteousness, would you just simply let God live through you? Let him live through you. Oh, then fourth, look here. There's the crown of life. Crown of life in James chapter 1 and verse 12. Look what it says. Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive what? The crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to him that love him. I want you to understand that we're all tempted. Amen? We're all tempted. But we don't have to deal with it. If we'll just stand with the Father, if we'll just stand on the Word of God and we'll resist that temptation, we'll receive the crown. The crown of life. Endures means don't fall for it. Oh, the tree of life looks good for the fruit, but don't pick it. Got to supply your needs. Yeah, I don't believe we need anything else. You know, we want a whole lot else. But I believe that God supplies our needs good enough. I mean, really? You see, we have to have the crown of victory. We see the crown of rejoicing. We see the crown of righteousness. We got the crown of life. And then look at your last one in 1 Peter chapter 5. We find the crown of glory. 1 Peter 5:4 says, and when the chief shepherd shall appear, you shall receive the crown of glory that fadeth not away. You made it. You made it. You made it. When I was in high school, we moved here from California, and the humidity is a little different from Los Angeles to Cullman, Alabama. It's a big difference because we didn't have humidity. And we started going to Good Hope and joined the football team, and I didn't realize you had to run so much in football, and I never played it until we got to Good Hope. And so here I am, I'm running. And we're supposed to run out from the school, down the road, down Highway 69 to a specific mile marker. Wasn't a landmark, you know. I was sort of hoping for the cow on the right side of the road to turn around at. But no, we had to run to a specific mile marker, if that'll tell you. And the first day I had to do it, they were telling me where we all had to run. And you know, I was last, obviously. And I was just trying to keep up with the last person, you know, that way at the last second I could pass them and not be last. Well, that didn't work out. But anyways, here I am, I'm running, and it's like 7 miles. Here we are, we're running, and you know, we finally get back to the, you know, we started running around 2:30, and everybody started running, and we started running around midnight that night. I finished, and and I got back to the school, and one of my coaches there, I won't call his name, but one of the coaches there, he's just standing there. Everybody, listen, literally, everybody else had gone home. The humidity was unbearable. I mean, I needed gills, okay? There was so much water in here. And he's standing there, just like this. And here I come, crawling up. And you know, the worst part about it is the field house was on top of a mountain. It was a hill, but at that day it was a mountain. Okay? And I get up to the field house, and he's standing there, and he's just... And all I could say was, I made it. I made it. Because all I want to do is make it. Doesn't matter who runs the New York or Boston Marathon. Doesn't matter about their times. All they want to do is make it. The crown of glory is that you made it. You made it through all the garbage, all the trial, all the temptation, everything that this world tried to throw at you, but you stayed with the crown of victory. You stayed with the crown of rejoicing. You stayed with the crown of righteousness. You stayed with the crown of life, and because you stayed with those four, you made it, and you received your crown of glory. Your crown of glory. Folks, I don't know what you're going through, but the crown of glory is close. It's close. You're going to be able to stand there. Can you picture yourself standing before Christ? And before anything is said, you say, I made it. I made it. Just want to make it. Did you make it? Are you going to make it? I want to give you one more verse and we're going to go home, okay? I want you to, if you would, if you have your Bibles, turn to Matthew. I want to show you something. It's close to the arrest of Christ. And Jesus and his disciples are walking, and something happens that is extraordinary. Because we see a picture of Christ talking to people. Talking to dead people. People that are hurting and sick. But I want to show you something. If you have your Bible, go ahead and turn to Matthew chapter 21. Isn't that right? Yeah, it's 21. I want us to be able to stand before Christ that day on your divine appointment. I want you to be able to stand there. And I want you to cast your crowns at the feet of Christ. That's my desire. I'm going to make it. Okay? I may come in last. That's okay. First is last and last is first. I'm good with that. Okay? I may come in huffing and puffing, but I'm going to stand before him. I'm going to go, I made it. But I want you to make it too. So I want you to see this for what it really means. This is going to blow your mind. Maybe. You probably are smarter than I am, so that's great. Now in the morning, as he returned into the city, he hungered. He what? He what? Okay, listen. Stay with me now. This is important. And when he saw the fig tree in the way, he came to it and found nothing there upon it, leaves only, and said, let no fruit grow on this tree henceforth forever. And presently, the fig tree withered away. Now, let's hold there. Do y'all remember how many days Jesus went without food in the wilderness? He wasn't hungry for food. But I often ask myself, what was he hungry for? And then it dawns on you, it dawns on me after you read it. Look what it says. He came to it and found nothing on it but leaves only. Now, he said something to the fig tree. Now, most folks probably would look at that and go, well, why? Why did he talk to a tree? Because he's Jesus. He's the Lord. He is the King. He is the Prince of Peace. And if he wants to talk to a tree, he can talk to a tree. But here's the illustration. This is what he's trying to tell us. You know who the tree is, right? The tree is Israel. The tree is you and I. And that tree, though it was pretty, it had leaves. It had leaves only, it said. Oh, they were Jews only in name only. Oh, they were Christians and they were pretty. They went to church. They did a few things along the way. Oh, they had leaves, but guess what? They didn't bear no fruit. They didn't bear no fruit. You see, the fig tree had leaves, but it had no fruit. You see, a lot of folks in this world want you to think they look good. They want you to think that they're going through they're just doing everything they need. I want to tell you something. Some folks just have leaves and don't produce any fruit. Well, we know, according to what John tells us, what happens to a tree that doesn't produce fruit. The branches are cut down and they're cast into the fire. And see, that's what he's talking about here. Listen, let no fruit grow on thee henceforth, forever, forever. Meaning, listen, if we don't do what Christ has called us to do, if we don't give our life to Him, then all we are leaves with no fruit. We've got to start producing some fruit. Evidences of our faith. Because there's going to be a time. There's going to be a time when we're going to stand before the throne of God and we're not going to have any fruit. And He's going to say, "Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I knew you not. Wither away. Be cast into the fire." You see, I want you to cast your crowns at the feet of Jesus. So let's not just have leaves. Let's not just look the part. Let's not just have leaves. Let's have fruit too. Because we're all going to stand before Christ. What are you going to have for Him? What are you going to have for Him? Let's pray. Father, we thank You. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that as we've looked at Your Word, we've brought glory and honor and power to You. Thank You, Father, for giving us everything we need. Father, I pray that we tap into it however You want us to. Father, I pray that there's somebody here that regardless of what they're going through, God, that they'll see that You're here. You were here before we got here. We love You. But today, Father, as we understand our divine appointment, may our branches have not just leaves, but fruit as well. We can only do that, Father, if we'll surrender to You. Help us, Father, surrender. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let's stand if we can. If you want to join this church, you come. We'll take care of everything. If you've never made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, today is the day of salvation. You need to come to this altar and pray. You come. Don't be hindered. Give God the glory. Give God the glory.
I pray that you really enjoyed our church service here at Cave Spring Baptist Church. But we want you to know the one called Jesus. Jesus, the Son of God. For the Bible tells us that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever shall be committed or believe in him shall have everlasting life. And we want you to know him. So if you've never made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, let me introduce you to the one called Jesus. For yes, he was born of a virgin, and he lived this life, and he lived it completely sinless. And as he died on the cross, he was thinking of you. And as he walked out of the tomb, he was thinking of you. You see, now he's seated at the right hand of God, and one day soon, and very soon, God's going to tap him on the shoulder and say, "Go get my children." And our prayer is that you are part of that call. So if you've never made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, would you pray this prayer with me? Jesus, forgive me of my sin. I know that I'm a sinner. Come into my heart and save my soul. Would you pray that prayer? If you've prayed that prayer, I want you to know we have to live that prayer, and it's a daily walk. It's not just a prayer. It's a life change. If you prayed that prayer, if you'll look at the bottom of the screen, you'll see a website. You'll be able to respond to us. Let us know about your decision. Now, if you'd like to join us here at Cave Spring, it's every Sunday morning, Sunday night. But Sunday morning we meet at 9 o'clock for small groups, 10:15 for worship. Sunday night we gather together again at 6 o'clock and have a great night of worship. We want you to be a part of the Cave Spring family. We'd love for you to continue to watch us, but you're welcome anytime. I hope we see you soon. God bless you. Have a great day.